On Hot Copy this morning, Senator Risa Hontiveros warning against increased incidents of Chinese cyber espionage ahead of next year's election. All right, we welcome on the show Senator Risa Hontiveros. Senator Risa, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen.
All right, let's start first with the President's State of the Nation address. Before we talk about the 2022 elections, this is the last that the president will be giving, and he's expected to flaunt the achievements of this administration. With a grade of 1 to 10, how would you grade this administration?
I'm sorry to tell you, Karen, yung grade na maibibigay ko would be closer to 1 than to 10. And actually, on various measures, kung pwede lang sana, negative, no? You said that indeed this is going to be his last SONA. Ito rin actually yung last chance niya na magbigay ng mas makatotohanan at mas useful na State of the Nation address, lalo na sa apat na malalaking issue. Corruption, yung pandemic response, lalo na ngayon laban sa Delta variant, yung economy, no, sa dami ng nawala ng trabaho at lalo na maliliit na negosyo na napilitang magsara. And last but not the least, finally, to stand up to China for Philippine national interests in the West Philippine Sea.
All right, Senator Risa, some may feel that grading this administration a 1 maybe too extreme, okay? Mm-hmm. Is there one achievement of this administration? What about build, some may argue?
Oh, okay. Speaking about build, sobrang illuminating yung article ni JC Punong Bayan na indeed build was supposed to be not only the centerpiece program of the administration, pero bibigyang daang daw niya ang isang golden age of infrastructure. Pero anong nangyari na nakita ni Mr. Punong Bayan? At least half of the big ticket projects that were originally included in the BBB list have had to be delisted as no longer feasible. Tapos may mga iba silang proyektong tinatakan lang ng BBB but are actually not physical infrastructure projects. For example, the national broadband or even the national ID system. And last, and perhaps worst, sabi ni JC Punong Bayan, yung mga malalaking proyekto which were actually started by previous administrations, they simply stamped with their initials of BBB. So, you know, from credit grabbing to misrepresentation to simply taking certain big awaited projects off the list. So, anong masasabi ni Presidente na na-achieve nila under the BBB label?
If you believe that this administration deserves a grade of 1, how do you explain the President's popularity?
I cannot. I can simply recognize na for whatever reasons, sa ating mga Pilipino, lumalabas sa surveys at pinag-aaralan din namin yan, Karen, at matimbang ang bigat niyan sa amin. For whatever reason, di umano, mataas pa sa surveys ang trust or approval or suporta ni Presidente. So that is simply something that we have to contend with bilang mga mamamayan, kami rin sa opposition, and all of us voters leading up to 2022.
Uh-oh. Do you attribute that, I'm curious, to a lack of one strong opposition candidate, or hypothetically, let's say, the feelings of fear that some people who were surveyed may feel?
Those could be factors, among others, Karen, at sinulat na rin yan ng mga, di ba, yung mga observers natin, or admitted or hinted at by the main survey outfits themselves. But nonetheless, ibig sabihin, ang trabahong nakaharap sa atin, no? Again, hindi lang kami sa opposition, pero lahat tayo mga mamamayan, and please, hinihiling ko rin patuloy sa inyo sa media, no, who are doing such a great service for us, the viewers, readers, listeners. The task left to us, Karen, going up to this last SONA of the president and the months and the years beyond is talagang ibunyag at pag-usapan ng makatotohanan the real situations on the ground, lalo na ngayong pandemya, lalo na ngayong resesyon, lalong, ayan, binubuli pa rin tayo ng China sa ating sariling dagat. And so moving forward, to be clear-eyed about what is to be done to rescue our health, rescue our economy, rescue our national dignity, and really once and for all address the long-standing issue of corruption with or without the president.
What do you believe is the biggest failure, so to speak, or a promise that's been broken by the president? I'm only asking this because you gave the administration a grade of 1, or even you said it could go negative. Palagay mo, ano po ba ang pangako na hindi natupad?
Ang pinakamatamis dapat na pangako, Karen, which the president made several kahit sa unang-una nilang SONA, naalala ko pa. Kaya pinakamasakit na yan yung napako ay yung pangako nilang iaahon yung buhay ng mga mahihirap. Ang daming agenda ng mga mahihirap na sektor na napako mula sa security of tenure para sa manggagawa hanggang sa mas maagang COCO levy fund law para sa mga maliliit na magdunyong natin, hanggang para sa mangingisda dapat sa West Philippine Sea. Sabi ni Presidente nung una, magje-jetski daw sila eh. Itatayo nila ang watawat natin doon sa West Philippine Sea. Hanggang ngayon, in the midst of this pandemic and this recession, Karen, sino yung pinangakuan ni Presidente? Pero napako ang pangako na protektahan sila. Ang mga mahihirap pa rin. Sila yung pinakamarami nagkakasakit at namamatay. Sila ang pinakamarami nawawala ng trabaho at hanap buhay at nagbubuktong.
So Senator Risa, you are contextualizing it when you mention those two things, COCO levy, and also even the promise of ending contractualization.
Yes.
You are actually veering away from the argument that we and nagka-pandemic eh.
The pandemic and the recession have made things worse.
Okay.
Ay, oo. Hindi nila pwedeng idahilan na dahil lamang. Totoong mas gumurumabe ang sitwasyon natin dahil sa pandemya, dahil sa recession. But with more, hindi lang sincere leadership, pero with more effective, no, clean leadership. Bago pa ng pandemya, una, dapat sana natupad, dapat tinupad yung mga pangako nila sa mga mahihirap, sa iba't ibang mga sektor. At kung ganun yung klase ng paggugobyerno nila, kahit sa gitna ng pandemya, kahit sa gitna ng resesyon, should be showing better health and economic outcomes now.
Okay.
Tulad ng ibang mga bansa. Hindi lang yung mga mas mauunlad, Karen. Those who are at similar development levels as us.
All right. Senator Hontiveros, you exposed a possible cyber involvement, so to speak, coming from China that may affect the Philippine elections. Can you expound on that? And do you have evidence and basis?
Well, my basis right now, Karen, ay yung ulat ng Kaspersky, that there are reports not only of previous and sustained China-based cyber espionage attacks against various countries, including the Philippines, pero na meron na daw mga number of government, Philippine government actors na kasama dito o tinarget dito at nabiktima na. So ayon sa Kaspersky, China has the capacity for such cyber espionage activities. Ang dapat natin itanong sa pamamagitan ng Departments of National Defense at saka Information and Communications Technology, may intention ba ang China? This would not be the first time actually, Karen. There have been earlier reports of such campaigns, for example, the one called Nikon, na ginagawa na ng China ilang taon na against several countries.
Do you believe China can influence the 2022 elections?
She can. And there had been earlier reports that she had already influenced earlier elections, not just here in the Philippines, but sa ibang mga bansa na may economic interest siya. And in fact, in the latest Kaspersky report, sinasabi nila na these Chinese cyber espionage campaigns are aimed at particular countries in Asia and Africa. Na, no surprise, Karen, dun din, dito rin sa mga continents or regions na ito, mayroong malalaking economic hindi ng agenda ang China, pero may mga na-capture na sila. We've heard of such economic takeovers by China in African countries and in other Asian countries besides the Philippines.
Okay, let's talk about the 2022 elections first. You are running for re-election.
Yes.
And the latest Pulse or Asia survey actually puts you along with other re-electionists, which is quite surprising, at number 14 to 22, although you do have a 97% awareness rating based on this particular survey. What do you make of this survey?
As I mentioned earlier, in relation to the president, inaaral ko yung mga survey results at para sa akin matimbang na konsiderasyon. At the same time, Karen, I've been in that situation before and fought my way forward. Medyo maraming buwan pa until several months until the filing, maraming buwan pa hanggang election, kampanya at election day mismo. So we still have time to build a broader, united, and strong not just opposition slate, but unity slate among opposition plus-plus. Lahat ng mga Pilipino na gusto ng ibang klase at mas mabuting klase ng administrasyon. And I'm part of those efforts and I hope to be part of that outcome.
Uh-oh. But the difference between your situation now and before is during your last, you came in 2010, correct?
No, 2016 only.
I
apologize. Yes, on my third and last try.
Is they say that former President Aquino, in effect, had a big influence on asking also the locals to support you and other candidates. And it was the same, yes, frankly, with President Duterte, to be fair,
yes,
and some of his candidates too, that came in the last elections. So how difficult will it be now that, number one, ABS-CBN is shut down, so there's less platforms for all candidates, right? All.
Right.
And number two, you have the administration clearly in control, so to speak, with the locals. Are you seeing a change on the ground?
Well, I hope to see more of that change on the ground. Alam ko na hindi yan a shutout possibility. Kasi yung mga LGUs din natin ang talagang frontliners bearing the brunt of the effect, not only of the kind of governance we have, pero plus itong brunt ng pandemya, brunt ng recession. Admittedly, Karen, it's going to be difficult. Pero hindi ako nagre-reklamo, hindi nagre-reklamo ang mga opposition. That's what being opposition about is about. Mas mahirap, mas challenging talaga siya. Pero higit pa sa opposition, ang pinaka-challenging talaga ay sa mga kababayan natin. Because it's all of us Filipinos feeling the effects of this malgovernance plus the pandemic plus the recession. So I choose to keep faith with our people, Karen, at malakas ang fighting spirit ko this past half decade hanggang sa ngayon leading up to the election.
Okay.
Tingnan natin kung sino ang mas mahihirapan at sino ang mas mananalo.
And are you still running under the Liberal Party?
Oh, I'm a member of Akbayan, a founding member, and I'll be Akbayan for life. In the past elections, sa Akbayan, nag-coalition partners kami sa LP, sa Magdalo, at sa iba pang mga partido at maraming civil society groups. And I do hope to further broaden that unity, Karen. As I said, opposition plus plus.
Okay. Are you speaking with NPC? I mean, clearly the coalition with LP was in a way what you were remembered for, no? Because of the president's popularity then. So will you be, I can't imagine you, of course, coalescing with PDP Laban, unless you're going to surprise everyone by saying you'll try. Would you?
I would have coalesced with the original PDP in the time of Canene Pimentel.
Not anymore.
The first ideological party.
What about NPC? What about NPC?
I really respect Sen Ping. We have close personal relations since the time of my late husband, who served well under him in the PNP. And I have appreciated the SPs raising the banner of the independence of the Senate several critical times in the past several years. So I wish them all the best. Sila yung unang nag-anunsyo kahapon ng kanilang kandidatura. And as I said, Karen, we still have time to forge the broadest possible united and strong slate for a fighting chance to end the kind of administration we have now and usher in a new and a different kind and a better one. At umaasa pa rin ako na
so you are not gonna coalesce. You are not gonna form an alliance with the NPC, with the Lacson-Soto tandem.
Nothing is on the table yet in terms of talks between Akbayan and NPC. Pero mga, to tell you Karen, mga dalawang taon ko nang kausap sina Sen Ping, VP Lenny, even Sen Grace, among others, about this idea of a united front. So okay. I think that is still on the table at magpupunusigi pa rin ako doon.
Okay, let's talk about VP Lenny. She admitted that she doubts her own viability, her own winnability for 2022, and she is weighing, in effect, would her 6% be, would that grow and make her win, or would that, for example, benefit another candidate? And she said, we can't take 6 years of the same. Those were her statements, not mine. So I'm curious, do you believe she should still run? Or at this point, do you believe that it's time already to really rally behind a stronger opposition candidate or another, an alternative? I think that's the best word, an alternative candidate against, let's say, the leading candidate today being Sara Duterte.
Oh, well, with all due respect, no, wala sa listahan po ng mga posible si Mayor. Pero speaking of VP Lenny, she's really one of the at least three presidentiables since 2 years ago nga na kausap ko. I think it's very responsible of her bilang pinakamataas na opposition leader namin hanggang ngayon to weigh things, to mull the possibility of an alternative. But until today, Karen, I think she is still, no, not just statistically, pero symbolically, one of the key figures na
yes, no doubt,
sa tingin ng mga tao, dapat i-consider.
So dapat malakasan na lang niya ang loob niya at tumakbo. Palagay mo, Senator Risa, just offhand. I mean, do you believe that sometimes it's a leap of faith? Gawin na lang niya? Anong nakikita niyo?
For sure, it's a leap of faith at ang lalim ng balon ng faith ni VP Lenny.
Okay.
At naniniwala ko, naranasan ko yung lakas ng loob niya. I just have to respect also that she feels the need to consider alternatives. But until the last moment, I know that isa siya sa pinakamalakas na possible contenders at pinakamalakas din na, if not queen maker or king maker, para pag-isahin at palakasin ang isang non-administration candidate para sa pagka-presidente. I have VP, full faith in
her. Yeah. So VP Lenny has admitted as far as, I'm not sure if it was meeting with Isko or dialoguing with him. Is that a possibility for you, supporting Mayor Isko as president? Who would you support for as president if VP Lenny doesn't run?
I would support, if VP Lenny doesn't run, I would support a candidate or a united front of candidates na committed to end this kind of terrible malgovernance na nararanasan natin the past half decade into this terrible pandemic.
But do you have a name? Session. I mean, do you have a name? Because there are just a few that can run, let's face it. You have Bongbong Marcos in the survey, Manny Pacquiao, Isko Moreno in the survey, and now you already have Lacson, who's already declared, so to speak, announced. So roughly you have four. So if she doesn't run, who personally would you choose? Who would you support?
I don't have a name yet as of this day, Karen. I have a similar, maybe short list than you mentioned. Pero hindi naman ito magiging unang kampanya na halos down to the wire yung pagbubuo ng hindi lang isang slate, but hopefully a broader united front slate. And I'm still really working on that, among others working on it.
All right. Yeah. Now, some people, some netizens have said, masyadong garapal yung pagtakbo ng Duterte-Duterte, right? But let's balance it. You have Harry Roque saying that the Duterte-Duterte won't happen, Ago Duterte won't happen, meaning at least in one party. But you also have others saying, what makes this different from, let's say, two Aquinos, two Macapagals? Bakit yun hindi tinawag na garapal? Go ahead, Senator.
We never had a President Aquino and Vice President Aquino. We never had a President Macapagal and a Vice President Macapagal.
At the same
and
time.
And in fairness to them, at the same time. So unprecedented itong pag-iisip ni Presidente allowed na tatakbo silang Vice President at posible sa isang slate na yung top two names ay magkapamilya. Unprecedented at simply unacceptable, Karen.
Okay, that's a good point. I've interviewed many people on this, and they've never pointed that out, that it's unprecedented, that it's at the same time. Because it's always brought up that Cory won, Noynoy ran, President Macapagal won, Gloria ran, but then you're talking about many years apart.
Apart, exactly. Hindi magkasabay.
Okay, moving forward, the Supreme Court just recently made a decision and said, frankly, that the president can evade the ICC and end the treaty on his own. What do you make of the Supreme Court's decision first? Were you surprised that they voted unanimously?
I'm very pleasantly surprised, or not surprised. I really welcome this ruling of the Supreme Court. Bagamat dinismiss nila yung mga petisyon tungkol dito, their ruling now clearly states for us, which is a very thick silver lining on our dark horizon, they clearly stated na hindi unlimited ang kapangyarihan ng presidente to withdraw from international treaties. And you know, as someone working in the Senate, I hear this with very glad ears na dahil kami bilang treaty-making body, we are particularly invested in this issue. At sinabi din ng Korte Suprema that the president, as you said, Karen, may not evade, is obliged to cooperate with the ICC kung ipagpatuloy nila yung kanilang proseso, particularly yung investigation. So I have bad news for human rights violators, Karen. They are not off the hook. Darating ang araw, mananagot sila sa mga heinous na gawain nila sa mamamayang Pilipino.
All right. There's a question here that came in. Can you ask Senator Hontiveros her thoughts about Willie Revillame running and or possibly running and Rafi Tulfo possibly throwing his hat in the ring?
Well, Mr. Revillame and Tulfo, like every citizen, have the right not only to vote, but to present themselves as candidates to be voted on by the electorate. So that's the same principle for every Filipino. So it will be up to the voters to decide.
Okay. You know, joining debates in the Philippines is not mandatory, right? That's the interesting part. Unlike the United States, where for you to be the representative of the party, you'd have to go through the debates within the party first. And do you believe that joining a debate should be made into a requirement? And I don't know if the COMELEC level alone can include that.
Sorry, medyo naghang ako, but I caught the beginning and the end of your main question. Well, hindi ko alam sa ibang mga partido, pero sa Akbayan Party, nagde-debate kami. But if you're talking about the highest debates and then the senatorial debates, yes, I wish it were mandatory for all of us. Pero kung hindi pa rin gagawin yun, lalo na ngayon sa panahong ito, and then hirap pa dahil sa pandemya, then we, the politicians, the candidates next year, must bring the content of that debate to the people. At baka nga hindi na namin kailangang dalhin yung buong yun, Karen, kasi yung debate, pumapasok na sa mismong puso ng mga tao, pumapasok sa mga tahanan natin. The debates are about the pandemic, the recession. The debates are out in our ocean about China. The debates are in our households about the corruption na nagnanakaw ng pera dapat para sa mga serbisyong panlipunan, lalo na ngayong pandemya at recession. But definitely, those are issues, debated or not, informal debates, na dadalhin namin, pag-uusapan at dapat papakinggan namin sa mga kababayan natin, sa mga botante.
All right. On that note, Senator Risa Hontiveros, I want to thank you so much for joining me this morning. God bless you and you take care.
I bless you.
Are you going around right now? You look like you're in the province.
I'm on the road.
I was going to say.
Out of town.
All right. Be careful with the Delta variant or the COVID variant.
Right.
Be careful.
Stay healthy also, Karen.
All right.
Will do. Salamat.
Thank you so much. That's Senator Risa Hontiveros.